Bubbles form spheres because it is the shape with the lowest surface area to volume ratio. You couldn't package that air in a more efficient way. Nature is good at working out things like that quickly. For example, if I was to dip this strange shape here into some soapy water, nature would figure out how to span this shape with the soap film whilst using the least amount of surface area. Quantum computing hopes to piggyback off this computational power of nature, and I hope that we can explore this concept a little bit more today. For this video, I've teamed up with Brilliant to show you through part of a course on quantum computing. It's a course made in collaboration with Microsoft and Alphabet X, companies which are taking quantum computing very seriously. We will work through the nature of computation quiz. And if by the end of the video you are still hungry to learn more about this topic, you can sign up for an account at brilliant.org/tibees. Using that link, you can get 20% off a Brilliant premium subscription. So, welcome to quantum computing. Our focus is learning how to exploit the laws of quantum mechanics in order to compute. So we need to see the big picture here, and we're going to do that by answering two questions. Number one, what is the nature of quantum computing? And number two, why do scientists think it will lead to speed-ups on a variety of important problems? So it says here that in the dawn of the 20th century, deterministic predictions from classical mechanics were failing to explain new experiments. I think I know one of the things they're talking about, and they have a picture of it here. It's the double slit experiment. And so a new theory was necessary to describe the results of experiments performed with quantum objects, that's photons, electrons, and other microscopic particles. Quantum mechanics foregoes deterministic predictions and instead embraces the concept of probability. So I guess with the double slit experiment, what's meaningful is the distribution of all of these particles that you end up with in the end, but actually the path of any single one of them, it seems random and doesn't really, you know, give you much information. It's the distribution of all of them together that leads you to understand what's going on. All right, so we've got classical mechanics, we've got quantum mechanics, and the course says here that we're going to now go on to play a little bit of a game. The game that we're going to play is one that I know as the Galton Board, although it apparently has other names. The game is a simple demonstration of how probabilities can emerge from a mechanical object. So each bin at the bottom is associated with a different prize, and the thrill is to watch as your fate is determined by the random bounces of the ball off the pegs. So you put a ball down here, it apparently randomly bounces off these pegs, or seems to do so, and lands in one of these bins at the bottom. That's the way it would classically happen with a ball and pegs, but we're going to remake it with our quantum objects, our photons. It asks us what is the most likely outcome of these games, and well, choosing from which bin the ball would land in, I would say it would most often land in bin number two. That would be the middle. Just because there are two different paths that it could take to end up in number two, where there's only one path to get into bin one or bin three. With a single photon, the quantum game behaves much like the mechanical version with the bouncing ball. The more possible paths that lead to a given outcome, the more likely that it is. But if we shoot two photons into the top of the grid, things get more interesting. When two or more photons meet somewhere on the grid, they can interfere with one another. Interference can lead to anything from the two photons adding constructively and appearing like two photons, or cancelling each other out entirely as if there were no photons at all. Yeah, thanks to this interference, we don't have any better way to find where the photons will most likely end up than to trace out all the paths each photon can take and calculate the interference effects where they meet. So we can't just add up the paths like we would do classically. So what we're concerned with here is that to predict the end state of a quantum object, we need to account for all the paths it could have taken to get there. And so how difficult is it to computationally predict the outcomes of this quantum game? In just this most simple example, where we're putting in two photons and we have two rows of beam splitters, then each photon can take one of four paths, leading to 16 different total combinations of paths. And that's 16 different interference calculations that we would need to do. Obviously, as the game gets larger with more photons or just more rows of beam splitters, it's going to get a lot more complicated. It tells us here that calculating the interference for each path combination is not too hard. It takes TC seconds. And it asks us, how much time does it take to calculate the photon distribution for a three-layer quantum game with two photons? So we need to figure out how many total path combinations there are, and then times that by TC to find out how long this calculation would take us. For two rows, we had 16 path combinations, and for three rows, we're going to have more than 16 because there is more possible paths that can be taken. So I'm going to put in 64 TC as my answer to how long this is going to take. Alright, so instead of doing all of those calculations, the question is, what if we just build this thing? So if we had a beam splitter, we can just shoot two photons into the top and use photon counters to find the distribution at the bottom experimentally, instead of even trying to work out the distribution. So for each measurement, the sampling time would be equal to the time the photons take to traverse the gap L from the first beam splitter to the row of photon counters at the speed of light. For a single beam splitter with two detectors, like this one here, this photon sampling time takes a time TQ. So the question is, how much time does it take for a three-layer experimental solve of this quantum game? Alright, so if TQ is how long it takes the photons to go from there to there, this looks like it's just three times as much. So I would go for three times TQ. So how long will a photon counting measurement in an n-layer game take experimentally? So if we had n layers, that would just be n times TQ. I think the idea here is that n times TQ is increasing a lot less quickly than our computational one, our 2 to the 2n. Yeah, so the time required in these two different methods, computational and experimental, are increasing at different rates as the number of layers of n increases. Our classical computation is increasing exponentially with n, whereas our quantum experiment is increasing only linearly with n. This is because the quantum objects in the experiment have no obligation to compute every path according to the rules of quantum mechanics, like we're trying to do with our computer. They obey quantum mechanics as a matter of course. It's just what nature does. If we assign a time to TQ from our quantum experiment and TC from our computational one, even though TC is lower than TQ, we can see visually down here what is really going to start to happen. So for a low number of rows in our experiment, it is quicker to, you know, just do it classically, to just figure it out. You know, if there's less than about 10 rows, we can just do some maths and work out the interference paths in a pretty quick time. But once you get up to about 11, 12 layers deep, it's really going up exponentially, and it's starting to take you ages each time to calculate all these paths. Whereas the quantum experiment, which is just going up linearly, although at the start it would take you a little bit longer to do it through the experiment, in the long run it will be much, much quicker. With the language we've been using, it's been kind of obvious that the classical approach is occurring on an actual computer, whereas the quantum approach, we could believe it's happening in kind of a lab experiment setup. But actually, because it says here, both methods produce the same information. So if one is a computation, so is the other. The basic truth of what's happening in quantum computing is that we're directly employing quantum objects to perform a specific computation. to whatever extent we can map and mold our computational problem onto quantum objects, we'll be able to use it to our advantage. If a problem has an inherent quantum aspect to it, like finding the interference pattern, then we could expect a quite big speed up. This problem was really hard to compute on a classical computer because the resources that it requires grow exponentially as n increases, but I like the way they say it here. It is quite easy to compute quantumly with an experiment, and I think that's basically what our quantum computer is doing. It's not an experiment in a lab like we might think with a Galton board and beam splitters and things like that, but we're mapping our problem onto quantum objects and kind of exploiting that way of nature to try and do things quicker. To take things back to where we started off the video, we can take a little look at this green sculpture here, which I think is really cool. And it is made of these big metal circles with a green fabric draped between them. So the shape we see here in the picture is apparently ideal in this way. It is impossible to find any other such smooth shape that contacts the metal rings while using any less material. All right, so this is an optimized sculpture. To figure out things like this, so to find this surface, this green surface computationally, is quite involved and requires algorithms built on sophisticated mathematics. The quiz asks us here, is there an easier way to work it out? And which phenomenon might be able to compute this surface in real time using the laws of physics? Well, if we go back to the start of the video, I used a soap bubble. A soap bubble always minimizes the surface area. So you can have a little look on this page. Yeah, natural systems like soap bubbles have a tendency to wiggle around until they minimize their energy. Minimization problems make up so much of physics, and you might have encountered them in problems before, things like the principle of least action, trying to, I guess, minimize the action on a path that an object would take. For a soap film, the energy is equal to its total surface area times its surface tension. So this is basically the energy required to keep the layer of soap stretched out. Here's another picture of dipping a spring into the soap, and this soap goes all the way around the fingers as well. There's your answer from nature, and here's your answer from an actual classical computer as well. I could try to use quite a complicated shape, one that is definitely very difficult to find the spanning surface area computationally. Nature, however, still gives me this answer instantly, and it's really fascinating. So you might consider the computational power of soapy water to be essentially zero, but if you have a very unique problem to solve, it can be far superior to a modern computer. I guess quantum computing is a bit about trying to make humans as clever as soapy water. We would like to piggyback nature to perform our calculation for us. So, in a real sense, quantum computers do not compute at all, but simply carry on according to the laws of physics. The extent to which quantum computing can revolutionize computation depends on us finding ways to restate computational problems in equivalent quantum systems. I think this kind of makes me realize that quantum computing is not really just a magical increase in all of the normal computing that we do and all of the normal problems that we try to solve on computers, but it's rather coming at computing from a different angle, and it's going to be up to us to be able to map our problems into the quantum world so that we can take advantage of quantum computing. But it's all very clever, and it also makes you realize how clever nature is itself, that, you know, nature can calculate these things so instantly and on such a grand scale, and I don't know if we really have any idea how it happens. I hope that you learned a thing or two in this video today, and thank you for watching.